Welcome. So in this video, I want to talk to you about word styles. I've had quite a few requests from people to say, look, could you explain what word styles are and why they're used? So I'm going to demonstrate a few different things here. I'm going to create some styles from scratch. I'm going to modify some styles. I'm also going to show you how you can use pre-existing styles and why they're useful, and how styles can be used in things like tables of contents and for navigation. So here I have a blank page. Let's say I just type in some random word to get us started. Now, before we do anything in terms of creating our own styles, there's a bunch of pre-existing styles you can tap into if you want to. They're on the Home tab, and there's a big section over here called Styles, and normal is like your baseline text. So it defaults to Calibri size 11, no bold, no italic, no extra effects. That's normal text. But as you come across, you'll see things like Heading 1. Now, as I hover over this, you see how the text over here is changing. So here's Heading 1, Heading 2, Title, Subtitle. And if we click this little button here called More, it opens up the full gallery, and there's other things here, each of which does something different to the text. So these are styles, and these are ones that Microsoft give you as a starting point, as a default. So at any point, I could go to, say, Heading 1, and click on that, and it styles my text for me. At any point, if I want to switch this style over to something else, I've just got to go to the New Style and click, and it changes over straight away. So let's create a style of our own. I'm just going to revert this back to normal, so this is like baseline text. Let's highlight it. Let's come up to here. So maybe I'll change the text to, let's say, Agent Orange. Let's increase the font size. Let's maybe add some color. Those kind of things. Whatever you do here in the font group, or if you wanted to, you could also apply some paragraph settings. When you create a style, it takes a snapshot of all those settings and saves them. It saves them up to here in the styles gallery as a style that can then be reused anywhere in the document. And if you wanted to, you can actually transfer the styles that you create to other documents. And at the end of this video, I'll show you how to do that too. So let's create a style based on this formatting. Now, there's two ways you can go from here. You can either right-click the text, choose the styles in this shortcut bar, and then choose Create a Style here. Or you can go to the Styles gallery itself, click the little More button, choose Create a Style underneath. It's exactly the same option, and you get this box here. So your preview box reflects how your style is currently looking. And all you've got to do is to name this style. So let's just call this My New Style. I'm going to click OK. And at the top here, in the Styles gallery, my new style has been added. When I press Enter, if you look at the Styles box at the top, you'll see that the new line is going to continue to use My New Style. Now, I may or I may not want that. Maybe I want the style to revert back to normal. And again, I'm going to show you how to do that in just a second. But for now, I'm going to do it manually. So anything I type here is going to be done in normal style. Now, normally, you have all your text set up ready to go before you apply your styles. So if that was the case, if I wanted to apply this style to this text, all I've got to do is to click somewhere in this paragraph, go to my style at the top, and click the style. And it applies that style to the whole paragraph. And you can go through your whole document in one sweep and apply the styles where they're required. When you do that, you get consistency. So you notice that this is exactly the same as this. And if you scale that up by 200 times, every time you use the style, it's going to be identical in the way it looks. That's the first big advantage of using styles. The other big advantage is how easy it is to modify or maintain your document with styles. So let's say I want to change this blue to a different color or change some other characteristic of this style. All I have to do is to go to the styles box at the top, right click and modify. What it does is it presents a dialog box with all of my style attributes listed. Now let me first do a really simple change just to show you how it applies to the document. And then what I'll do is I'll walk you through all the stuff that's in this dialog box. Now, the section in the middle contains the main kind of stuff that you want to deal with or change on a style. So for this one, let's say we just want to change the color. When I click OK, every instance where I've used that style has now changed. So again, if you scaled that up by 200 times, let's say you had 200 headings in your document, one modification will go through and apply that to every time it's been used in the document. And that's a massive advantage, and it makes your life so much easier in terms of keeping on top of your styles. So let's look at that dialog box in a bit more detail. I'm going to go to my style and right click and choose modify. Now firstly, the name at the top is whatever you call it. The style type, it normally defaults to linked paragraph and character, and that's what you want. What that means is that whatever you do in terms of settings, you can either select the text or you can just place your cursor anywhere in a paragraph and it will apply these settings to the whole paragraph. Style based on normal. Now you can actually base it on anything you like, but I recommend keeping it as normal. Think of normal as like your baseline text. If all of your styles that you create start from the same point, it makes your life so much easier. Some people make the mistake of basing one style on another style they've already created. And that has the effect that if you change the first style, it has a rolling effect, like a chain reaction, and any other styles based on the first style will also change. So I recommend against that, just keep this as normal, and just make sure that all of your styles start from the same point. The style for the following paragraph, see how it's set to my new style. And that's why, when I pressed enter before, it defaulted to continue using that style. Again, I think it's easy to use if you set this style for the following paragraph back to normal. That way, whenever you press enter, it goes back to regular text. Now, as I said before, this section in the middle, they've collected together all the kind of things you want to use on a regular basis for styles. So here you've got your font and your font size, your bold, italic, underline, and your font color. Underneath, you have more paragraph settings. So you've got your left alignment, center, right alignment, justified text. You have your single spacing, 1.5 spacing, double spacing. You have options here to increase the space between paragraphs or decrease space between paragraphs. And you've got your indents and outlines here. So these are kind of the regular things you do. You're not limited to that. I'll show you in a second where to go to get further options. But all of these tools here can be found on your home tab in the font group and the paragraph group. It's the most commonly used options for styles. If you want to go deeper, there's lots of other options you can set, and you get to them through the format button in the bottom left here. Let me just move this up first and click format. It provides you with 9 categories of stuff that you can change. The first two are what we've been working with already, so the font and the paragraph. Where this shows the most common options, this will show you all the options. So if we click font, this dialog box here contains all the stuff you'd ever want to do with fonts. It includes all the normal stuff you get in your font group on the home tab, but it also includes extra stuff like small caps, all caps, and hidden text. Now, all caps means all capital letters all the same size. Small caps means all capital letters, but the proper capital letters are bigger. There's also the advanced tab here. Now, I'm not going to spend any time going through this, but this allows you to change your scale. Scale lets you play with the width of each character, each letter. So 100% is normal, but if you wanted a narrower kind of letter, you might reduce this to 80%. Or if you want a wider letter, you could maybe increase it to 125 or 150%. Spacing is to do with the space between each letter. So if you've chosen a font that's actually quite crowded and you want to spread it out a little bit, spacing is your option there. So this isn't a video to go through every option here, but there's lots of stuff on the font you can play with. Let's cancel that for a second. Under format again, next category is paragraph. The options you see here reflect all the options you see in the paragraph group on your home tab, plus more again. So you've got things like the alignment, you've got the left and right indentation, you've got your hanging options, first line hanging or none, you've got the spacing before and after the paragraph, and the line spacing. There's also things like line and page breaks, which lets you control, you know, how two paragraphs act together in terms of the end of a page. Not going to go through it in this video, but again, there's lots of paragraph options to play with. The next category under the font button is tabs. Now, tabs, in my opinion, not everybody agrees, are obsolete. They've really been replaced by tables. You get a lot more control with tables in terms of positioning stuff on your page. The next category is border. Now, border is referring to borders and shading in terms of the paragraph itself. So under borders, you've got all your box, your shadow, your 3D type borders here. Or if you want to be specific, over here, just like regular borders, you can choose your line type, whether it's solid, dotted, dashed, etc. Your color, now automatic just means black, but you can choose any color from the palette. And your width, as in how thick it is. Once you've chosen these three attributes, you can come over here and set your top, bottom, left, and right borders for the paragraph. The other side of that is the shading. Again, just choose whatever shading color you want to use. And shading is like the fill color for the paragraph box. The next category under format is language. So it defaults to whatever language is currently set for your computer, but you can change that if you want to. You can also say, do not check spelling or grammar, and that attaches itself to the style itself. So if the style is applied, any normal spell checks that might be applied, if this is ticked, won't apply. The next category under format is frame. Now again, this is here for legacy reasons. It's been superseded a long time ago. The thing that superseded it is text boxes, which can be found on the insert tab. The next category is numbering. Now numbering refers to bullets and numbering. So when you choose this, you get the choice. This is single level bullets only, not multi-level. You can't define that here. For that, you have to actually go through the multi-level numbering option. And then once you've established your numbering system, attach the style to the numbering system that way. Now the last two options on the format tab, just quickly, you have the shortcut key. So if you want to assign a shortcut key to activate the style, you can set it here. And then just off the screen there, you have text effects. So text effects is like shadows and reflections and all the stuff you get if you do things like word art and that kind of stuff. So 9 categories and lots of options that can be set for each style. Now, as for these few options down here, let me explain what these are. Now, where it says add to the styles gallery, that's ticked by default. And that's why when we created our style here, it added itself to the style up here. If you don't want that to happen, just untick it, of course. Now, automatically update. It's off as a default option. And the reason it's off is because, let's say you had 10 headings in your document, which were all styled with the same style. On one of those headings only, let's say you want to make a change. If this was set to automatically update, if you made that change to that one heading, all 10 of the headings would change because you've set it to automatically update. That's why I recommend leaving this unticked. So leave the default settings, because that then allows you to change just one, if you ever had to, without it affecting all the others. The other two options down the bottom, you'll notice they're radio buttons, which means you can either choose one or the other. So it defaults to only be available in this document, or all new documents based on this template. So if this is a style that you're going to use in other documents, you may want to set this option here, and it then becomes available in all new documents. What actually happens is the style gets added to what's called the normal template, the normal.dotm, and a bit later in this video, I'll explain what that's about too. So that's the express tour of all the settings you can change for a style. Let's just cancel that for now. Now you can create as many of your own styles as you like. Generally speaking, you don't actually need that many to cover a whole document. Maybe 4 or 5 styles would do. There's also all the inbuilt headings, like heading 1 and heading 2 and so on. And if you wanted to, you can just modify any of these for your own purposes. So to demonstrate this, I'm going to need a bit more text. I've just put in a really simple structure. This is my first heading down here. This is my second heading, my third heading, and it goes down to 5 headings there. I've also got a couple of subheadings underneath the first heading there, and a bunch of random text in the middle. So what I can do here is, if I go to the left-hand margin here, get my white arrow and just click in line with that first heading, it selects the entire line. I'm going to hold down the control key and select also the second heading, third heading, fourth heading, and fifth heading. And in the styles gallery at the top, apply the heading 1 style. It doesn't matter how it looks at the moment, in a minute I'm going to modify this. I'm also going to choose the subheading and another subheading, and just apply the heading 2 style to that one. The random text, as you can see, is just using the default normal style there, just your normal body text. Now, for my heading 1 or heading 2s, if I want to modify the style, I haven't got to select anything first. I can just go straight to the heading 1 at the top here, right-click and modify. And let's say that I just want to increase the font size to maybe a 20, maybe apply some bold, maybe change the color, just so we can see visually the difference there. Everything else can stay the same. Let's click OK there and see how all of the major headings here have changed in one hit. If I do the same for heading 2, right-click, modify, and let's make some change. Let's maybe make the second one italic. Let's change the color to green, and maybe increase the font size to 14. And click OK. So again, major headings, subheadings. That's how easy it is to modify, and it applies all the way through your document wherever you've used it. When you do use the standard heading 1 through to heading 9 styles, there's lots of other benefits that come into play. As you hover over a heading here, you can see one of the first ones here, which is the little arrow that appears on the left-hand side. So when I click the arrow, it collapses up everything in this section. So it hides all that information. And to get it back, you just click the other arrow that's appeared there, and it reappears. So heading 1, being like the major headings, it collapses all the stuff within that. It could be like 50 pages big, and it collapses the whole thing. If you want to go to a heading 2, you get the same kind of thing. But obviously, this is a lower level, so when you click on this, it just collapses that section. And when you click the arrow, it reappears. So you can go through your document at any time and just collapse up either, you know, some lower level headings or some higher level or top level headings. And it's a really easy way to hide the stuff you're not currently working on and get to the stuff you really need. Another feature is the navigation pane. So if I go to my view tab at the top and choose navigation pane here, it gives me a side panel. And all the stuff that's been styled with heading 1, heading 2, heading 3 and so on is listed down here as a hierarchy. And again, if I click on the arrows here, I can collapse up these details within the navigation pane itself, or show them by clicking again. But the main purpose of this is it's a quick way to get to that section. So this is like a table of contents that sits on the side there. It's all built in. And all you've got to do is to click, say, this is my third heading, and it takes me straight to that point. This is my fifth heading. It takes me straight to that point. It doesn't matter what page it's in or what position the document is in, it takes you straight there. So it's a fantastic navigation tool, gets you around the document really quickly. Let me just turn that off. And the final thing I want to show you using these heading styles is how you can build a table of contents really quickly. So let's go to the top here. I'm going to add a couple of blank lines at the top for my table of contents. Let's just select those two lines there, and on the Home tab, convert it back to normal text. Let's add a heading that says Table of Contents. Now the table of contents text itself can be styled to any style, but what I wouldn't do is to style it as the heading 1. Because if you do that, when we build our table of contents in just a second, it's going to include that line as part of the table of contents, which doesn't actually make a lot of sense. So you might want to just use something like the title style or something like that, and you can modify from there if you want to. The great thing about using the heading styles is that table of contents can be built automatically and in a way that if the content changes, the table of contents also changes. And it's as simple as this. So you position your cursor, that's going to be the point where the table of contents gets inserted. We then go to references, and on the left here, you have your table of contents section. The table of contents icon gives you a number of preset options. And if you didn't want to take it any further, you can actually choose any one of these options here, and it will build the table of contents in one click. But let me take you behind the scenes a little bit and show you some of the features of tables of contents. It's really a lot easier than you think. So I'm going to choose custom table of contents. And this dialog box here is where it's all controlled. So firstly, there's three levels currently showing. In my text, of course, I'm only using two levels. So I'm actually going to reduce the levels here down to two. Where it says formats from template, this is referring to the style that you want your table of contents displayed as. So this is the from template style. If I come into here and choose some of these others, just check the preview here of each one. So there's seven different options available, and you can choose whichever style you want to apply for your table of contents. Let's just stick with formal for this one. You'll notice how I'm starting down the bottom and working my way up. The reason for that is that as you choose whatever format you want here, it changes some of these settings here. So firstly, the tab leader. That's the little character there that connects the item with the page number. It's always a good idea to have one of these. I think the dots works best, but you also have the choice to have dashes or underscores if you want to. Right align the page numbers. Again, I think that's a good option to leave set on. That way you've got your page numbers over here and your items separated over here. If you don't right align your page numbers, the page numbers go right next to the item. And in my opinion, that looks rubbish. Also, show page numbers. I'm not actually sure why that's even an option. I don't know why you'd have a table of contents without page numbers, but make sure it's left on and we're ready to go. So I'm going to click OK to insert the table of contents. And if I was to click on here, you'll see how it gives the gray background. And whenever you see a gray background in Word, it means that it's controlled by Word. So it's something that you don't have to worry about anymore or manipulate manually. This is taken care of for you. At the moment, of course, all of my content is on one page. But here's where it gets interesting, because if I come down here, I'm going to put my cursor in front of the second heading and press Control Enter to insert a page break. So that's now gone onto a second page. And let's maybe put my third heading onto a third page. Again, I press Control Enter there. And let's go back to the top and see how that affects the table of contents. Now, at the moment, it's as it was. So all you've got to do is to click on the table of contents to get that gray heading reappearing. And at this point, you can either press F9 on the keyboard, which is your update key, or you can right click and choose Update Field here. Either way, we'll give you this dialog box, and you've got two choices. If your content hasn't changed, but you've just put stuff onto different pages, you could just update the page numbers only. But if you've added content, removed content, changed content around, or restructured it in whatever way, you probably want to choose Update Entire Table. That drags all the new content into your table of contents and gives you a fresh set of page numbers. So when we click OK here, you can see that we've got page 1, 2, and 3, which reflects how our document currently is. Now, one final thing here. If you want to reuse your styles in other documents or other new documents that you create, you can manage them and move them around and copy them around as much as you want to. And what you do is you go back to the Home tab, you go to your Styles Gallery here, you click the launcher in the bottom right corner of the Styles Gallery, and it gives you a side panel here. Down the bottom of the side panel, the third icon at the bottom says Manage Styles. That gives you a dialog box here. In the bottom left of the dialog box, you choose Import and Export. So there's a few steps to get there, but once you're here, this is where you manage your styles. So there's two lists. This list here on the left shows you styles for the current document. The list on the right shows you the styles for this normal.dotm that I mentioned before, the normal template. So anything listed in here, anything in addition to the regular styles, will then appear and be made available in any new document you create. So what you can do, you can maybe take your three heading styles here, or possibly the My New Style that you just created, and copy it across to your normal template. That then becomes available for new documents. If you want to copy your styles and make them available in other pre-existing documents, in that second document, you'll come to this point here, display the organizer, and do the reverse. So you take it out of the normal template into that second document. And that's how you manage styles. So I really hope this video has been useful for you. Styles are a really powerful and really quite an integral part of Microsoft Word these days. And if you can get a good grip on how to use them and start using them, it's going to save you a stack of time and make you a much better user.